Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents When Parents Hurt. Compassionate Strategies When You and Your Grown Child Don't Get Along. By Joshua Coleman, PhD. Narrated by Paul Boehmer. 1. Parents on the Firing Line.
Dear Mom,
I have decided that I don't want to have any contact with you ever again. Please don't write or call me anymore. I can't stop thinking about all of the ways that you were never there for me when I was growing up. Whenever I see or talk to you, I just end up feeling depressed, angry, and upset for weeks afterwards. It's just not worth it to me, and I need to get on with my life. Please respect my wishes and don't contact me again. Letter from Clarice, 23, to her mother Fiona, 48. Fiona sat on my couch in her first visit, without looking at me or saying anything. She reached into her purse and handed me the letter from her daughter, as if to say, "This says it all." And it did. As a psychologist, I've counseled many adult children like Fiona's daughter. In some cases, I've helped them to craft letters just like hers, or supported them in cutting off contact with a mother, a father, or both. I know the finality that these letters can portend. It's a deadly serious business, and the stakes are huge. A therapist has no business giving advice in this arena unless he or she has carefully thought about the long-term implications of these decisions. I felt for this desolate mother, sitting in front of me, because I knew that the letter could be the last contact that Fiona would ever have with her daughter. A flood of questions were already circulating in my mind. Why is her daughter so angry at her? What has Fiona done to try to repair it? How capable has she been of taking responsibility or listening in a non-defensive way to her daughter's complaints? How receptive will she be to my recommendations for how to respond? "I'm sorry," I said, handing back the letter. "That must be so painful." Fiona looked relieved, as though she had expected me to blame her. "I worry about her all of the time, and can't stop wondering what horrible thing I did to make my own child turn against me. I'm sure I made my fair share of mistakes, but I wasn't that different with her than I was with the other three." She started sobbing. "Clarice was always the hardest of my four children. Even when she was young, she seemed so impossible to please. We did everything for her, individual therapy, family therapy, medication, you name it. Nothing seemed to make her feel happy or connected to us. My other kids resented her because she sucked all of the time, energy, and money out of the family that should have gone to all four of them. She won't talk to my other kids either, except for the youngest." "It's really heartbreaking," she said, grabbing for the Kleenex. "It is so goddamned heartbreaking." Are parents to blame? Not that long ago, I would have assumed that Fiona must have done something terribly wrong to cause her daughter to respond in such a dramatic way. My training as a psychologist taught me that the problems of the adult child can always be linked to some form of mistreatment from the parent. While this is often true, it doesn't hold for all families. And when it is true, it's often a far more complex picture than most therapists and self-help authors realize. As I worked with Fiona over the next few months, I came to understand that she had been a reasonable and conscientious mother. As her story and others illustrate, it is possible to be a devoted and conscientious parent and still have it go badly. You can do everything right, and your child can still grow up and not want to have the kind of relationship with you that you always hoped you'd have. You can do everything right, and your child may still end up with a drug problem that costs you thousands of dollars and endless heartache. You can do everything right, and your child may still choose the kind of friends or partners that you never imagined she would have chosen because these people seem so lost and are dragging your child into losing more. You can do everything right, and your child can still fail to launch a successful adulthood despite being gifted and talented or possessing an IQ that most people would kill for. Very few of us escape feeling guilt toward our offspring. It may be part of our evolutionary heritage, a way that nature hardwires us to stay sensitive to them even after they are grown. And some parents are responsible for transgressions that are harmful to their children. Child abuse, incest, neglect, and alcoholism are a few of the more egregious examples. However, whether the parenting mistakes are subtle or serious, real or imagined, today's parents are completely confused by their children's failures and accusations. They need guidance and support for themselves, not more advice about their children. Who is this book for? This book is written for parents who carry enormous feelings of guilt, shame, and regret about how they treated their children. Parents raising children with a diagnosis or temperament that makes them harder to parent and maybe harder to love. Parents whose divorces have created a profound change in the quality of their relationship with their child. This includes children who are rejecting or blaming them, refusing contact with them, or seem to be damaged by the divorce. Parents whose current or ex-spouses are dedicated to bringing them down in the eyes of their child. Parents who were devoted and conscientious, yet their adult child refuses contact with them. Parents whose partner, parent/step-parent, boyfriend/girlfriend, makes it difficult to provide the kind of safety or nurturance that they want to give their children. Parents who are mismatched in some important way with their child. For example, a successful and driven parent with a learning disabled child. A vulnerable, insecure parent with an aggressive and rejecting child. A depressed parent with an active, risk-taking child. Parents who are wounded by their grown child's inability to launch a happy or successful life. The wounds caused by teens and adult children. Since parenting a child at any age has its challenges and provocations, I could have started with childbirth and continued through each developmental stage. However, I have chosen to limit my topic to the wounds caused by teenagers and adult children. I start with teenagers because adolescence is the place where some of the hardest confrontations begin to be waged between parent and child. While many parents hope or pray that their young child will one day outgrow her problems, her trapeze-like mood swings, her difficulty fitting in, her defiant and insufferable temperament, most begin to realize by adolescence that their soon-to-be adult may be no different and no easier than the very same child was at ages 2, 5, and 10. It's only the hair and clothing that have changed. Adult children are another story. Financial strings aside, a young adult has almost total discretion to spend time with you or not. The only time younger children have similar latitude is in divorce, where the courts or living arrangements enable the child to have much more choice over how much time he will spend with a non-custodial parent. In other words, adult children are even freer to launch salvos against the parents' happiness and well-being, to have their own versions of how they were raised, and to state those claims with authority. It was their childhood, not yours. Their experience, not yours. And now, in case it wasn't perfectly clear, their adulthood. With adult children, closeness or distance is negotiated on an equal playing field, a field with rules unheard of before in history. Not a parenting book. For all of its glory and gut-busting work, parenting is a dangerous undertaking. You put in long hours, examine every decision and action, do the best you can, and yet, the child who once adored and needed you can come to reject, shame, or belittle you. The youth who was to be your greatest source of joy and pride can become your greatest source of worry and disappointment. The sweet kid who wrote you love notes and gave you hugs has written you off, or gives you the finger instead. This book was written for parents who have concluded, after years of therapy, medication trials, soul searching, or family interventions, that they should stop listening to all of those other parents, pediatricians, psychologists, and talk show experts who say that if they only do steps 1 through 7, they too can have the relationship with their child that they always wanted. They have decided that these well-meaning advisors are naive, misinformed, or plain ignorant and wrong, because, frankly, they are. Their advice is based on a parenting model that offers little to those who are greeted by pain, guilt, or disappointment every time they open the door to their teenager's room or try to get their grown child to return their calls. Upcoming chapters. Chapter 2 will help to provide clarity about where you are right now with your child and will help you understand how you got there. It outlines the many ways you can become hurt as a parent and will provide questions to help you begin to think about how you got there and where you need to go. While all parents experience feelings of guilt, some parents are chronically plagued by the belief that they have damaged their children, sometimes without any corresponding evidence. Chapters 3 and 4 are written to provide guidance for parents who feel guilty about their behavior in the past, or who need help dealing with their child's accusations in the present. Our current ideals about parenting and children are historically unprecedented. Most of our ideas about what children need and who parents are supposed to be are flawed in many, many ways. These ideas greatly contribute to parents' feelings of shame and failure. They contribute to children and others feeling entitled to blame parents for the children's problems, inadequacies, or poor relationship with the parent. Parents and children are constructs whose definitions change with every century, if not every few decades. Chapter 5 seeks to place today's parent in a historical and economic context. Chapter 6 examines the shame that so many parents feel when they have strained relationships with a child. We'll examine the basis for your vulnerability to shame and provide guidelines and exercises for working through those feelings. Chapter 7 details the problems that occur when a parent and child are temperamentally mismatched. A mismatch occurs when what comes naturally to the parent is completely at odds with who the child is, and sometimes at odds with what he or she needs. We'll look at how temperamental mismatches can create long-term conflict in the parent-child relationship and provide recommendations and solutions. Teenagers can cause parents to feel inadequate, enraged, scared, and hopeless. Today's parents of teens face special challenges because of the peer group's increasing power to supplant the parent's authority. Chapter 8 is written to help parents manage the thorny cluster of emotions provoked by difficult teenagers and to provide guidance on how and when to intervene. Chapter 9 looks at the guilt, disruption, and loss that parents feel with divorce. It will also examine the ways that ex-spouses and stepfamily issues may contribute to the alienation divorced parents sometimes feel with their children. Guidelines and exercises will be provided. While divorce can strain the relationships between parents and children, a difficult marriage can do the same. In Chapter 10, We look at the wounds that occur when your spouse or partner makes it harder for you to be a good parent. Some common situations are spouses or partners with poor communication skills, anger management problems, abusive behaviors, psychiatric disorders, or addictions. Guidance and exercises will be offered. In Chapter 11, I will provide help for those parents whose hurt comes from having a teen or grown child who can't get his or her life developed and launched. This will cover those children who have already moved out of the home and those who are still living there. One of the most painful experiences for a parent is to have a grown child who refuses to have a relationship or who makes that relationship extremely difficult. Chapter 12 is written for parents whose adult children have rejected them, either through constant blame or by completely cutting off contact. Guidelines will be given about when to pursue, when to back off, and how to gain serenity. Part of what makes parenting difficult is the way that children can trigger painful feelings from our own childhoods. In Chapter 13, we'll consider how your own childhood history affects your parenting and your response to your child's treatment of you. Recommendations, exercises, and guidelines will be given. Who is this book for? This book is for you, if you have lost something important during your years of raising children, your bearings or your self-esteem, the opportunity to be the parent you desperately wanted to be, or the potential to repair the damage from your own painful childhood. While there are thousands of books telling you how to better raise your children, there are none written on a topic that is just as important, healing the wounds of the parent. If this is your goal, this book is written for you. 2. Getting it wrong about parents. Defining the problem. I am often consulted by a mother or father who has, just the night before, scolded his or her toddler for some disagreeable behavior, such as biting his sister on the nose or kicking the cat while it was en route to the litter box. These parents ask if they should start saving up now for the inevitable trip to the therapist's office. They envision this child recounting to a nodding therapist the time mother cruelly and unjustly scolded him for innocently playing with his sister or sweetly petting the family cat. Mom was such a bitch. No wonder I have intimacy issues. While some parenting behaviors can create problems in children, I believe we need a much more nuanced and complete picture than the one currently being provided by therapists, politicians, and talk show hosts. A larger picture is necessary because influences such as genes, economics, peer groups, siblings, culture, and personality can cause some kids to make their mediocre parents look and feel pretty great, while others make their exceptional parents look and feel pretty awful. Some children, just by their nature, create a lot of parental error and heartache. Some environments create problems in children that have little to do with whether mom or dad are following the latest and greatest parenting advice to a T. Since parenting is a science of approximations, there is no perfect outcome or intervention for every single child. In an attempt to make a sensitive child feel safe, we could be accused of being excessively protective and not providing an environment where she could learn to tolerate anxiety and fear. In an effort to make a defiant child more compliant, we could be blamed for being overly restrictive and for missing those times when he's cooperative and interested. These mistakes may stem from our attempts to be loving, or from being worn down, intensely worried, or just incredibly irritated by having to provide feedback to a system that is constantly in need of rebalancing. While parents are expected to love all of their children equally, parents don't feel the same way about all of their children, both when they're young and when they're grown, And is it any wonder? A child who radiates affection and love toward his affection and love-starved parent is going to get a lot more response and tenderness than one who is inconsolable, defiant, and withdrawn. Difficult children of any stripe tend to bring out behaviors and emotions that we would prefer to avoid seeing in ourselves or letting the rest of the world know about. They make us lose our tempers and say stupid, hurtful things that we could never imagine saying, and pray no one overhears at the grocery store or at our in-laws' dining room table. Difficulties with children of any age can make parents feel depressed, shamed, and jealous of all those other parents who have it so easy. Perfecting parenting. Research psychologist Diana Baumrind has influenced many parents and psychologists with her theory of authoritative parenting. It's a useful concept and one that I often suggest to parents who are looking for general guidelines. From this perspective, there are three types of parents: authoritarian, permissive, and authoritative. Authoritarian parents are characterized by using too much control and showing very little affection. Permissive parents are characterized by showing a lot of affection and very little control. Authoritative parents show a lot of affection and a lot of control. Her findings reveal that, all things considered, authoritative parenting is the best predictor for successful development. So, one can easily conclude, if you're authoritative, then presto, mold the perfect child into a healthy adult by providing a healthy mixture of affection and control. But it doesn't always work that way. Part of what makes parenting so confusing, and therefore so treacherous, is that what works for kid A may be useless for kid B. Some parents are great with certain types of kids and clueless with others, better with boys than girls, better with girls than boys, better with cats than either. And some kids are just easy to raise. I met a couple of these well-behaved youths a few years ago when I went to visit a childhood friend in Los Angeles. After introducing me to his wife, we sat down in his living room. Other than the radio turned quietly to a classic rock station, the house was eerily quiet. "Oh, darn," I said, looking around at his suspiciously well-kept home. "What's the matter?" he asked. "I was hoping to meet your daughters. I thought you said they'd be here." "Oh, they're here. They're playing together in the next room. I think they're probably reading together or just hanging out. Emily, Elise, come out. I want you to meet somebody." His daughters, aged 9 and 13, came into the living room in the way that kids on TV walk into a room, smiling, peaceful, well paid. "I'd like you to meet my friend, Josh." "Hi, Josh," the older one said. "Hi, Josh," the younger one said in the same way, only younger. The girls sat down in front of us on the floor while Kenny and I talked for an hour and a half without interruption. An hour and a half. An hour and a half. "Man," I said, "how do you get them to do that?" "Oh, they're always like that. They're really good kids." Aha, there it was. They're good kids. But aren't mine good? Does practicing World Wrestling Federation takedown moves in the checkout aisle of the grocery store make them bad? Does the fact that they constantly interrupt me when I have friends over, despite my calmly asking them to wait a second? "Wait a second, honey. You're interrupting, okay? 1 second, honey, okay? Can you let me finish a freaking thought?" Make them bad kids? "Yeah, mine are good too," I said. "And they are good. It's just that they're not easy. They're not remotely easy. In fact, my boys are loud, rowdy, and constantly in motion, and because of that, a larger percentage of my parental reserves go toward containing and corralling them so they don't disassemble our house and build a skateboard ramp out of the spare parts. I was far more patient with my daughter than I am with them. Her nature was calm and introspective, which freed up time for playing, talking, or reading. What a concept. Because my boys are fraternal twins, I have my own ad hoc science experiment going and can observe how reasonably consistent parenting results in radically different 15-year-old boys. For example, one of them seems wired for immunity to parental intervention. If a conversation is going to finally and gracelessly end in, "because I said so," it will be with him. I adore him and admire his strength of character. However, he has trouble understanding the consonant and vowel combination that forms the word no. And that means that we're going to tangle more than I wish. Authoritative parenting characterized by calm and clear limit setting? Sure, after a few martinis. The other twin is the opposite. When I'm feeling impatient, I can see the shadow of my mood inhabit him like a low-grade fever. Where the first one seems oblivious to my behavior, this one tracks it like sonar on a shifting ocean floor. It makes him sensitive and thoughtful and vulnerable to taking things much more personally than I would ever wish for him. My grown daughter lives temperamentally between the two. She is adaptive like the latter twin, but her nature bends and bends only to whip back up and smack you in the face if you aren't paying attention. She was easy when young, but reclaimed every inch in adolescence and early adulthood that she ceded in childhood. It's through my relationship with my daughter that I decided to write this book. I was married and divorced in my 20s, and remarried 19 years ago, ergo the twins. While my daughter and I are now very close, we went through several years when she was a young adult where she hardly returned my calls and expressed little interest in seeing me. Those were hard and disorienting years. Scratch that. Those were the most painful and confusing years of my life. We all expect to let go of our children at some point. In many ways, we start grieving the loss of them as they take their first wobbling steps away from us. But no parent wants it like that. Not years later when you find yourself staring at a 3x5 photo of her when she was sitting on your shoulders at the age of 3, her head happily and innocently inclined against yours, smiling at a blue, cloudless sky. Never when you want so badly to be a good, loving parent and reap the rewards that seem so obvious and secure in a world where, increasingly, so little seems guaranteed. Never anticipating a future when you would have to constantly try to stitch something together, a weekend, a day, a letter, a phone call to try and mend the torn tissues of connection caused by the bomb crater of divorce and its unexploded shells. Never, never, never. Yet, whether you're divorced or married, it can happen. And, as judged by my clients and friends, it happens a lot. I constantly hear from mothers and fathers who are carrying deep feelings of loss and longing, guilt and grief, anger and shame, regret about how they treated their kids, regret about how their kids treat them, regret about how all of their lives turned out. Regret, regret, regret. And they all want to know, what are you supposed to do with those feelings? Who is supposed to understand your waking and sleeping sorrow about the life your child is living with or without you? Or the worry that your child may never, ever get it together and become a full-functioning adult? Or the prospect of never again seeing or being close to one of the most important people in your world? How do you admit what you're feeling to others when doing so risks inviting more shame from their well-meaning, but often hurtful or disorienting advice? Advice generated from the premise, however inexplicit, that you must have done something wrong to create distance or problems in a relationship that most assume is inviolate. I can write about this because those years seem safely behind me, or so I hope. Whatever needed to be bridged has been bridged, and the water beneath my daughter and me runs relatively clear. Fortunately, I had a few friends who had been through similar ruptures, or were going through theirs at the same time, friends whose teens or young adults were struggling with addiction, eating disorders, anxiety, depression, cutting themselves, suicide attempts, school failure, or just pushing them away. Having other parents to offer their own wisdom and guidance, who can calm you down when you want to launch an outraged letter to your child, a payback for withdrawal, a deluge of unwanted advice, is priceless. As a result of my own experience, I feel nothing but compassion for the parents I work with, who show me the self-righteous, guilt-tripping letter that they just mailed to their son or daughter, detailing all of the ways they feel so worried, so mistreated, so devalued, so abandoned. Parents who, in desperation and anguish, write some version of, "Screw you, you ungrateful brat. I'm tired of being treated like the bad guy. If you want to see me or change our relationship, you can reach out to me for a change." My response is almost always the same. I can totally understand why you would write that. It makes complete sense to me. However, I think you now have to write your kid a different letter. Much of this book will be about that different letter. To be clear, I'm not as interested here in your child as I am in you. Your child, however precious, can get into therapy if he or she needs to. My focus is on you and your well-being. If I offer you parenting advice, and occasionally I will, it has less to do with my desire for you to be a good parent and more with my wish to get you back on your feet. You need a guide, because there aren't a lot out there on this subject. The internal world of the parent is almost a taboo topic, except where it relates to marshaling the resources to create a perfect child. It's not just the parent. In case I haven't made it clear, there are many outside influences affecting how you feel and how your kids turn out, other than your behavior as a parent. The parent-child relationship does not occur in a void. New findings in the field of behavioral genetics, for example, suggest that children are equally likely to affect how parents behave. Despite decades of research in child development, many of us are still oriented somewhere between Jean-Jacques Rousseau's view of children as total innocence and John Locke's belief that they are blank canvases for parents to paint their ambitions and desires upon. This book seeks to reframe that view. The recent findings in child development and genetics are relevant because they show that children come into the world spring-loaded for action far more than anyone previously thought. They're checking us out and seeing what works pretty much from the moment they pop out of the womb. This research shows that about half of the way that children behave has nothing to do with the quantity of affection and active listening and stimulating environments that we provide, and a lot to do with what that bodybuilder, DNA, tells it to. Moreover, when most people, psychologists especially, talk about nature versus nurture, we assume the nurture part is parenting behavior. It turns out that a more accurate calculus is 50% genes and 50% environment, with environment defined as a bunch of players in addition to mom, dad, and a cruel older brother. From this perspective, a well-rounded view of environment has to answer the following questions. How does the parent respond to the inherited temperament of the child? For example, we now know that an aggressive temperament in a child greatly increases the chance for an aggressive reaction in the parent. Behavioral geneticists refer to this as child-to-parent effects. How do the genes of the parent affect the parent's behavior and reactions to the child? How do the siblings respond to the child or to the child's relationship with the parent. Studies show that children constantly compare how their parents treat their siblings with how they are treated, and that this perceived difference in treatment can affect their development. In addition, studies in genetics show that siblings are incredibly different from each other, and that these differences may affect their perceptions of the parent as good or bad, fair or unfair, loving or neglectful. But wait, there are more factors affecting child development. Which peer group does the child choose, and why? From which is she excluded? What positive experiences does he have with teachers or other significant people that move his life in a particular direction? What negative experiences does he have? How much is available to the developing teen or young adult in terms of employment or meaningful activities outside of the home? These factors are important in providing the stepping stones to successful adulthood, regardless of what parents provide. And that's not all. What are the culture's prescriptions for parental involvement in managing their child's behavior? What is the economic status of the parents, and what advantages and protection does it offer? How does the parent's economic status affect the availability and choice of peer group or educational opportunities available to the child? How much insulation does economic status provide against the more destructive aspects of the culture? How much institutional and governmental support does the culture provide for parents and children? What are the culture's prescriptions about how involved a community should be in raising children? Children versus parents. As if all of these weren't enough, children themselves from the very beginning have their own agendas for their best interests, interests that are often in conflict with those of the parent. You may feel at odds with your child now, but if you're a mother, the battle between you began in pregnancy. As soon as the embryo was formed, it began sending out powerful hormonal messages to build a placenta and lay out supply lines for food, space, and a comfortable womb. It took control of your pituitary gland and caused it to synthesize large amounts of chorionic gonadotropic hormone to ensure that the pregnancy was protected and maintained. Over the course of your pregnancy, it was your budding baby, not you, who was in charge of your body. In most pregnancies, this orchestration proceeds in a cooperative manner between mother and soon-to-be child, but sometimes it goes awry, such as when mom's body can't counter the fetal demand for sugar-rich blood, and gestational diabetes develops as a result. In other words, well before there was a teenager to talk back to you, there was a fetus with its own agenda and strategy to ensure that it got a full serving of what it needed to survive and thrive, including potentially endangering the well-being of the very person who was giving it a place to live. Sound familiar? And that's just the pregnancy. After childbirth, the contest between what is good for baby and what is good for mom and dad continues. Human infants require the most protracted period of dependency of any primate. As a result, they require a huge investment of parental time and resources, resources that may threaten the very survival of the mother, father, or clan. From the very beginning, babies are checking us out to see what causes us to turn toward them and what results in our turning away. Infants as young as 1 year have been shown to reassure mothers who appear distressed, or to try and soothe other children who are upset. By the age of 36 months, children are active at getting their mothers to turn their attention away from their siblings and back into the orbit of the developing toddler. From the child's perspective, their very survival depends on an ability to obtain as many critical resources as they can from the parent in time, nutrients, and emotional investment, while trying hard not to alienate that parent who is their lifeline. Because infants and small children are relatively powerless, they have to use whatever talents they have to get what they desperately need. As evolutionary biologist Robert Trivers writes, An offspring cannot fling its mother to the ground and nurse at will. It has to use whatever means it has at its disposal. These mechanisms include being adorable, screaming loudly, and in general, being a squeaky wheel and outmaneuvering siblings for a larger slice of the parental pie. In this way, the goals of the parent and of the child can be at odds, because the parent, in addition to nurturing any particular child, has to spread her resources across her children, herself, and other family members in as judicious a manner as possible. We don't have as much control as we may think over how our children turn out, in part because it's not necessarily in their best interest to cede that much control. Okay, you're probably thinking. There are other factors, but it still doesn't show me how to deal with all of the pain I'm going through. I know, I'll get there. Help is on the way. Let's start by finding out where you are right now, by answering a few questions. Defining the problem questionnaire. Choose the items that best describe you or your experience. You may decide that multiple answers apply, which is fine. You may find it helpful to take notes as you go along. Keep a journal of your thoughts and feelings, or write about the themes that you find particularly useful or upsetting. This section is provided more to define the problem than to solve it. Solving it comes next. What were your hopes and dreams when you became a parent? My child and I would be best friends or very close. I would be able to be a better parent than my parents or to give my children what I never received. Parenting would be one of the most meaningful experiences in my life. I could help my child excel in school, sports, popularity, and other areas. I would be able to experience a deep and profound love. How have you been disappointed in those dreams? I feel as though my child hates me. I often dislike my child and wish I'd never become a parent. I feel disappointed in who my child has become and the kind of life he or she has chosen. I have made many of the same mistakes that my parents made with me. I have been a much better parent than my parents, yet my child makes me feel like a failure in my role. I believe that someone else could have done a much better job raising my child than I have, and that makes me feel sad and ashamed. Which emotion do you feel the most burdensome in regards to your child? Guilt. Anxiety. Fear, anger, worry, sorrow, regret, frustration, disappointment, all of the above. What do you think is the biggest cause of that emotion? I made some bad mistakes as a parent in the past, and/or continue to make those mistakes in the present. My child thinks I wasn't a good parent in the past, even though I believe that I was. My child thinks I'm not a good parent in the present, even though I believe that I am. My divorce has created problems in the quality or quantity of time I get with my children. My ex's behavior has alienated my child from me. I have a hard time relating to my child's temperament. My child is very rejecting. My child doesn't seem like other children. This makes me constantly worried about his future. My partner or ex is causing problems in my child. The stress in my marriage or relationship makes me overreact to my children. My own personal problems cause me to be less effective as a parent than I'd like to be. I worked out of the home too much while my child was growing up, and I carry deep feelings of worry or regret. I have guilt for using physical punishment. How has your role as a parent affected the rest of your life? I feel depressed and overwhelmed most of the time. I have a hard time focusing on the rest of my life. I feel guilt-ridden and worried most of the time. I feel as if my identity and self-esteem have been damaged. I feel overcome with feelings of sadness and grief. I feel angry, bitter and resentful. I feel scared for my child's future. My marriage and my other relationships have been negatively affected. My work has suffered. I feel preoccupied with my child or my relationship with her all of the time. How to use this book. Every parent has her own individual challenges. There are no one-size-fits-all solutions to these dilemmas. Depending on your situation, I may advise you to simply wait and be patient, or I may recommend that you continue to reach out to your teen or adult, no matter how unrewarding it is or how crappy it feels. In some situations, I'll advise you to take a lot of responsibility for the rift in the relationship, and at other times, to correct a very distorted view of yourself that's being projected onto you. A parent who was abusive will need a different set of responses than a parent who was not abusive, but is being accused of being that way. A parent whose child is rejecting them at 16 may need a different response to that child if she is 21, 28, or 40. In addition, a teen who is mouthy and obnoxious will need a different set of responses from the parent than a teen who is bulimic or suicidal. I have organized this book with the idea that exercises are useful for some listeners and not for others. Some people can't stand cognitive behavioral exercises. Others are loath to have events constantly referenced back to own childhoods. Some find guidelines useful, while others do better with education, information, or practical advice. Therefore, most chapters will have some mix of all of this. There are certain principles that are essential to your healing. These principles are based on hundreds of studies about what helps people recover from emotional injury and maintain immunity to future emotional and physiological stress. I have summarized them here. You don't need to commit them to memory. We'll be developing them in detail as we go along. The essential principles. Your healing will be strengthened as you begin to fearlessly take responsibility for whatever ways that you have contributed to the problems in your relationship with your child or your children. Make amends for the ways that you were wrong. Move toward forgiving your child for how he or she hurt you in the past or in the present. This doesn't mean condoning or excusing bad behavior or minimizing your hurt. Move toward forgiving yourself for your mistakes as a parent. Develop compassion for your child. Develop compassion for yourself. Move anger, guilt, shame, and regret into the background of your life, and move hope, gratitude, and optimism into the foreground. Develop an identity and life story based upon your strengths and achievements as a parent and individual, instead of a story about your suffering or failures. Get and maintain support from friends, family, or your faith. Give something back to society. I know those are a lot of steps, and each step requires work. However, the strength that you'll get from working on these essential steps will radiate positively into the rest of your life. One of the most important steps for any parent to get a hold of is managing guilt. This is where we turn next. 3. Parental guilt. Healing the real or imaginary mistakes of parenting. Parents who believe that they have damaged their children carry huge feelings of guilt, shame, and regret. In some families, these parents behaved in ways that truly were harmful and injurious. However, even subtle parenting mistakes, or those caused through good intentions, can leave parents with lasting scars. In addition, many parents wrongly believe that they caused injury because they have no calculus by which to measure their children's accusations. These beliefs may be particularly troublesome because they can make the parent behave in ways that create new problems. Being a good parent today means being sensitive to our kids' complaints in a way that would have been unheard of in prior generations. While this sensitivity increases the potential for a closer, more fulfilling relationship, it also increases the chance that the parent will be made to feel inadequate, shamed, or guilty in the process. Consider the following examples and watch how the accusations become increasingly confusing in terms of what is required of the parent. A toddler falls on the sidewalk and gets mad at his mother for not preventing it. A toddler falls on the sidewalk and the father gets mad at the mother for not preventing it. A teacher of a 10-year-old calls the parents and says that she suspects their son is having problems at school because of what's been going on at home lately. A 13-year-old tells her mother that she hates her because she's so self-centered and adds, "No wonder Dad wanted to divorce you." An 18-year-old tells her parents that her cocaine addiction was a cry for help and demands to know why didn't they see it earlier and get her into treatment. A 20-year-old drops out of college after the second year and tells his parents, "It's your fault because you've always put so much pressure on me to succeed. You never cared about what makes me happy." A 30-year-old refuses to have any contact with his mother because he says that she has never taken responsibility for the ways that she was a bad parent. Prior to the second half of the 20th century, fewer parents would have been confused about how to handle these scenarios, especially with children still living in the home. They were insulated by the belief that it is the child's obligation to demonstrate his worth to the parent, and not the other way around. Old-school parents would have responded that the kid was being disrespectful and needed to be properly put in his place. While this wasn't always the better approach, this philosophy protected parents from the kind of guilt, self-doubt, confusion, and anguish that greet today's parents when confronted with their children's complaints. This chapter looks at the role of guilt in creating parental suffering and the thorny terrain of living with children's criticism and rejection. It is written for parents who made serious mistakes in their parenting and for those who were relatively innocent in their behavior. It is also written for those parents in that common and confusing area lying somewhere in between. The costs of denying guilt.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.